Good morning. Good morning and welcome. Before we distribute the Cistercian rings to our juniors, we have several awards to recognize this first semester. The Promising Young Writers Program represents the commitment of the National Council of Teachers of English, the NCTE, to early and continuing work in the development of writing. Cistercian was invited to nominate one eighth grader who has distinguished himself in his writing. Congratulations to fourth former Samuel Minnery, who will submit a portfolio in February in hopes of earning special recognition for his writing. Congratulations, Samuel. Cistercian also nominates one junior to the NCTE Writing Award competition. This nominee must assemble and submit a portfolio of his best writing, but must also write an additional essay on a topic selected by NCTE. Congratulations to seventh former Matthew Saltell, chosen by the English department to represent Cistercian in this national competition. Well done, Matthew. Ongoing efforts to celebrate excellence in Catholic education. The Catholic Foundation annually honors one outstanding high school junior from the Dallas Diocese with the Catholic Foundation Scholars Award. Cistercian's nominee from the junior class was Johnny De La Cruz. Nominees for the scholarship were selected based upon academic achievement, leadership at their school, community service, and an essay entitled, "What My Catholic Education Means to Me." Well, as was mentioned earlier at the Mass, we received word just yesterday that by a unanimous decision, this year's diocesan winner will be Johnny De La Cruz. Of this morning's ceremony. And I am most happy to introduce this year's ring speaker. Elected by his peers to introduce his class, because of his positive attitude and because of an unconventional, charming wit that often catches people by surprise. He's a tremendous athlete who always works hard and knows the game of basketball as well as anyone. A lover of learning, who often asks some of the most insightful and probing questions in class. And an authentic servant leader, having initiated and organized Cistercian's Hurricane Harvey relief effort this year, among his other volunteer efforts. Please now welcome to the stage, Mr. Jack O'Neill.
Abbot Peter, Father Paul, Father Ambrose, and the class of 2019. Welcome to this year's ring ceremony. And to my class, thank you for electing me to tell our tale. The purpose of telling the form story is to recount what has shaped us leading up to this moment and capture the essence of the form at Cistercian. By looking back on our memories, we have an opportunity to delight in the joyful times, remember the strenuous trials we underwent, and just as necessary, look into the future and forge a purpose for ourselves and a purpose for the rest of our time at Cistercian. Over our time here, we have been shaped into something recognizably good through the collective efforts of ourselves, parents, and faculty, as well as the time and pressure Cistercian has exerted on the raw materials from which we are all formed. When we first arrived, young and eager to prove ourselves, the brotherly scuffles preceded the camaraderie we possess today. Having just become a priest, there is no doubt that our foremaster was distressed when he was put in charge of a group of tax collectors and rebels and not the outstanding group of young men he was promised. Bendy rulers being used to discourage classmates, sharpshooting anything available in the classroom, and even the occasional tar and feathering during 10-minute break surely gave our beloved Father Ambrose a headache. At this point in time, our potential is not so clean-cut and obvious, but careful polishing eventually would smooth away some of the rough patches and imperfections. Though it can be said our time here began when we were introduced to Father Ambrose, or when we arrived for opening ceremonies, the day we began our advance through the school as a unified group was one day during Foremaster's period. Father Ambrose decided to take us to the hidden field, and with him, he brought a massive ball, the size of 3 firstformers. He sat it on the muddy ground and pronounced that the two sides of the form should engage in a gruesome struggle to move the ball across the field against the opposing side's effort. Because what better activity for a group of 10-year-olds than to clash against each other in a swamp with the goal of controlling the path of a colossal rubber spear? This series of events foreshadowed the rest of our careers at Cistercian. As would always happen when we were given the opportunity to use teamwork and persevere towards something productive, we instead tore down what we perceived as forced upon us. And we bonded over that. In this case, it meant that the ball would see its last day. Even though the ball was popped, we left the field muddy and content that we had accomplished something together. Whether or not what we accomplished was actually the intended goal never crossed our minds. We were simply happy to enjoy the moment. Now, it's not that our form was always intentionally destructive. Then again, neither is a bull in a china shop. One day, inadvertent havoc was wrought in a rather unfortunate place, the Abbey Church. The mass started like any other class mass in middle school, but something would soon become unhinged. Apparently, during all the renovations to the campus, Cistercian forgot to replace its sacramental bell that was so old it must have come from St. Peter's storage closet. When the time came for the altar server to ring the ancient bell, it simply fell apart, and faster than a poorly constructed popsicle stick bridge in Coach Taylor's science class. As was the case in those days, nothing was funnier to us than something going awry, so we immediately began laughing and jumping around. This proved to be a horrible mistake. After Mass, the form was introduced to a new side of its foremaster, the side that had an obligation to rein in the immaturity that sometimes got the better of us. This was a time for a different kind of form growth than that on the hidden field. It was an opportunity to learn about respect, maturity, and huge class penances. As middle school went on, we had the opportunity to participate in some new activities. When sports came in 7th grade, Coach Dotson began to chisel away at our egos, one ego in particular, and help us grow in humility, teamwork, and trust. Another first came when 8th grade offered us a new kind of interaction, one with girls. Although our interactions with them were not always easy, they did distract us from trying to find new ways to physically and emotionally terrorize one another in the classroom. With each of these came more refinement within the form, more focus on the good things we could achieve together, and our fraternal community was growing stronger. Despite our many imperfections still, we'd begun to show some potential. The upper school would serve to mold us into more mature, considerate, and thoughtful young men. When it came at last, we were eager to try new things. We got to experience the freshman baptism, host the mixer, and attend homecoming as a form. No doubt this year of parties, paintball outings, and a rivalry basketball game followed by Coach Parker's triumphant dab was liable. Even in the upper school classrooms, our form bonded over the new responsibility we were entrusted with and the lessons we would learn. One important lesson is that no matter how hard you try, a pizza cannot conduct electricity. More important lessons came from what seemed to be our constant struggle with teachers. One such incident involved many dejected core members dealing with a certain freshman theology test that yielded grades mostly beginning with the number 3. It was not a completely dark situation, though, because no matter what happened, we always had the prospect of folding for a 50 on the next quiz. Because of all our various conflicts, our form has had our times when we've needed to be disciplined. I know that may be hard to believe. Whether it be some form members digging a 100-foot-long irrigation ditch on the baseball field, mandatory study halls during lunch, or being publicly humbled by Mr. Saliga, each brought a different lesson that ground out impurities in the form. Through our form's conflicts with other form members, teachers, or those that everyone goes through personally, there has always been a wiser, more experienced older brother, a prudent father, a role model, and a mediator to help us resolve our issues. He has given us gifts of innumerable books, so many books, like 3 books every year for 7 years to read in our free time, and even a new class hamster to replace our dearly missed class mouse. But most importantly, Father Ambrose has given us compassionate understanding, constructive criticism, and he has served as a catalyst for the transformation that this form has undergone since first one. For this, we thank you, Father Ambrose, for everything you've done for us. High school has largely provided us with many fond memories. We have had many instances of us coming together to create something everyone could enjoy. Sophomore year, we revolutionized the lunch period. Gone were the days of lounging around and maybe doing some homework. Lunch was for sports. We created a lunch sports league complete with seasons for various games such as capture the flag, basketball, but most importantly, tennis, baseball. There were referees, rivalries, star players, spectators, and of course the team chaplain, Father Ambrose. 2 students even purchased a portable grill to serve hot dogs and hamburgers to the famished crowd. The spirit of competition permeated everything we did, as did our recklessness at times. Not so surprisingly, we were often late to classes, out of uniform, and ill-prepared for basically any assignment that year that was after lunch. The games led to chipped teeth, stitches, and probable concussions. But most importantly, they led to an unbreakable bond between classmates. Even though there was still breaking and messiness, the form as a whole strove to choose unity as the driving force behind the playful and somewhat irresponsible games. That year of playing sports during lunch, through rain, snow, and inconveniently scheduled history quizzes, was another step in our transformation from the unruly and childish demeanor we once displayed to the slightly more responsible disposition we have assumed this year. After looking back over our journey thus far, it is time to think about today. We are receiving our class rings, a sign that we have made it through 6 years in this unique place and have another year and a half to go. Our rings are symbolic of the form, but also symbolic of what the form is capable of. because unlike these rings, we are not yet finished. But both us and the rings began in the same state, as raw materials. Neither we nor the rings were always as polished, unified, or suave as we are today. But the value of the metals and stones in the rings was made apparent after long periods of intense pressure and heat. Even then, it took a determined jeweler to form the ring into something that could be worn. For us, Cistercian provided the arduous environment. Parents took time, effort, and made sacrifices to mine the heavy ore and bring us to Father Ambrose, who in turn took our organic substance with sharp, unyielding edges, imperfections, and flaws, and fashioned us into what we are today. Gentlemen, we have come a long way from the boys who first walked through these doors to the young men seated here today, and we're not done yet. Let these rings serve as a reminder to stay on the path moving away from the destructive tendencies we once possessed towards the constructive tendencies that we have begun to acquire. Let us hold fast to our desire to see our brothers fulfill their potential. This noble aspect of the form's character that's always been with us, if we continue to follow and revere it, will surely lead to even more progress than we have already made. Now, let's get our rings.
Would you please come forward to give the juniors their senior Cistercian rings? Fernando Mateo Acuna. Jose Manuel Alonso. William Arpey. Jose Gregorio Ignacio Vaquero Degwitt. Jace Jackson Bartz. Giovanni Bertocco. Samuel Elliott Clay. Aiden Flint Click. John Martin Corrigan. Harry Dodd Crutcher. Sebastian Reese Erlin. Jonathan Seth De La Cruz. Patrick James Dundon. Eric Christopher Easley. Anthony George Farha. James Emil Garda. Samuel J. Fernandez. Brian Christopher Jane. Campbell Patrick Keating. Samuel John Kirby. Robert Michael Larman. Christopher David McCallum. Patrick James McLean. David Navarro. John Patrick O'Neill. William Allen Parker. Kevin Paul. Samuel Alexander Reimer. Maximilian Benedict Rogers. Andres Ruben Saez. David Nathaniel Sanchez. Benjamin Peter Sanford. Matthew Patrick Sautel. Braden John Smith. John Paul Spock. James Charles Oliver. Bennett Martin Vaughn. Joseph Eugene Wagner. Lucas John Watts. Samuel Edward Wilcox. Thomas Paul Worth III. Nguyen. And Brandon Lee Zimmer. To conclude this morning's ring ceremonies, Father Abbott, would you please impart an apostolic blessing?
Please stand. May Almighty God bless us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May everyone have a safe and a refreshing and a joyful Christmas. And I present to you very gratefully and gladly the class of 2019. Have a merry and safe Christmas.
Here, boy. Roll over. Good dog.